Gaming journalism evolved right alongside gaming itself, rising and falling with it. It was nearly wiped out when the gaming industry crashed back in 1983, but it rose like a phoenix from the ashes and is now stronger than ever. Though it has changed a lot along the way, it is barely recognizable from how it started. The first published gaming magazine was Playmeter in 1974. This magazine covered coin-operated arcade games and was aimed more at the business side of things rather than the gamers themselves. Gaming journalism really began to pick up steam in 1981, with the rise of Computer and Video Games Magazine and Electronic Games Magazine. Electronic Games was published by Bill the Game Doctor Kunkel, who some considered to be the grandfather of video games journalism. Though both aimed at gamers, they had different tones. Computer and Video Games Magazine covered all aspects of gaming, including basic programming for simple games so that you can make your own at home, whereas Electronic Games focused more on commercial and readily available products. These two magazines had one thing glaringly in common, and that was their journalistic style. You may think this is a no-brainer.
Well, they are magazines. Makes sense that they are written by journalists.
It does make sense, you're right. But that would soon change. Gaming journalism started with journalists turned gamers, but was slowly overtaken by gamers turned journalists. This change put factual analysis on the back burner and brought entertainment to the forefront. Though it brought in a bigger audience, and a younger audience, it brought up the question of whether gaming journalism is really journalism at all. A British magazine called Personal Computer Games was one of the first to do this, followed by Crash magazine, which featured reviews written by kids. While some more traditional industry folks saw this sort of writing as amateurish, the readers responded very positively. Of course, not all magazines followed this trend, thus splitting the industry in half, the serious journalists and the gaming enthusiasts. That being said, with the devastating crash of the video games market in 1983, most magazines closed up shop, and what was once a flooded market became a barren wasteland. This didn't last long, though. When the popularity of video games began to rise once again, so did video games journalism. The 80s saw the rise of these enthusiastic publications, like Famitsu in 1986, still the most influential gaming publication in Japan, Nintendo Power in 1988, and both Electronic Gaming Monthly and GamePro in 1989. All of these magazines provided news, information, and thoughtful analysis while at the same time entertaining their audience. Game developers began to throw their hats into the ring, producing their own, totally not biased, gaming magazines. EB Games began to release Game Informer, and Future Publishing's Edge magazine pulled onto the scene. Even already established gaming magazines got pulled into the corporate monopoly. Computer Gaming World, in 2006, was transformed into a Microsoft-only magazine called Games for Windows, the official magazine. But let's step back for a second. In the 1990s, with the rise of home consoles, came the rise of video games into pop culture. More people than ever were interested in the gaming world. This brought more demand, and as magazines scrambled to keep up, gaming websites swooped in for the kill. The first dedicated gaming website was launched in November 1994, when print fanzine Game Zero became a fully online production. Other companies began to follow suit, moving from print to online. But this was slow going. Websites were put on the back burner at first, responsibility of them handed off to junior writers, the lowest on the totem pole, resulting in rushed work full of errors. This gave the perception that online writing was less mature than print, simply because the more experienced writers didn't want to waste their time on something that they thought was just a side endeavor. From this and other beginnings came today's overwhelming saturation of game sites, as well as the downward spiral in game journalistic quality. Once upon a time, you had to have some journalistic know-how. Now anyone with a keyboard can review a game. The internet as a resource is a double-edged sword. Sure, we have more access to information faster, but it is often questionable and unreliable. With the accessibility of it all, there's no way to prove what is fact and what is merely opinion. Some say this is good, freedom of information, but others, mainly professional journalists, bristle at the words video games journalism. Quite a few modern games journalism sites are often accused of biased reviews, of taking money from game developers to produce a positive review of their upcoming game. This puts games journalism on even rockier ground. Riding the line in modern games journalism has split a lot of game journalistic sites into three basic categories. 1. Focusing on the purely business side of things, like Gamasutra or GamesIndustry.biz. 2. Collecting raw data, like GameRankings.com or Metacritic. 3. Simply going unapologetically opinionated rather than factual, often called new games journalism. Popular blog sites like Kotaku or Destructoid provide gamers with information regarding industry trends, but also make waves when the industry flounders. Meanwhile, the webcomic Penny Arcade has carved its own niche by taking a comedic approach to game journalism as a whole. The rise of YouTube and Twitch influencers has changed games journalism even more. More and more people turn to influencers rather than written reviews for information on new games. This trend has become so popular that game developers are catching on as well, preferring to cater to internet personalities instead of review-specific websites. The interesting thing is that the influencers don't necessarily play by the same rules or follow the same standards as the traditional gaming journalism. They're almost all opinion and little to no facts. Their strong force of personality and large fan bases turn their words into gospel among the younger generation, a great example of the vocal minority. Most of the younger generation would rather watch a video than read an article. This makes influencers more valuable than ever. Twitch and YouTube celebrities are on the rise and seem to be the future of video games journalism. This development may also mark the end of games journalism credibility as well. Though this isn't a bad or less efficient route, it simply means they will not be following the rules set out by the predecessors before them. I guess that means they'll just be making their own rules from now on. Video games journalism has come a long way, and has changed drastically over time. Who knows what it will look like in 20 years from now? We'll just have to wait and see.